wáyà jà má jẹ̀bi. Àtìlẹ́yìn má tìlẹ̀ lójú. Ọba tó fi inú wúndí aṣọ látúfi inú ọmọ ènìyàn ṣogbo. Kábíọ́ sí. Our God of Abraham, God of Isaac, God of Jacob. Daddy, you are the Lord God of the Holy Prophets. You are the beginning and you are the ending. You are the fountain of living waters. You are the Son of Righteousness. You are the Holy One of Israel. You are the Father of the Fatherless. You are the Lord God, the Man of War. You are the Ancient of Days. You are the I Am that I Am. You are the Immortal God, the One that dwells in the night. You are the Invisible God. You are the Rose of Sharon, Satisfaction of the Flood. You are the Lily of the Valley, and the Lord is your name. You are the Everlasting King. You are Jehovah Nisi, God Abana, Jehovah Jireh, God our Provider, Jehovah Shalom, God our Peace. Jehovah Rophe, the Mighty Healer. Jehovah El Shaddai, our Mighty and All-Sufficient God. Jehovah Sidken, the God of Righteousness. Jehovah Elohim, our God is holy. Jehovah Elohim, our eternal creator. Jehovah Rohi, the Lord is my shepherd. Jehovah Adonai, our suffering God. Jehovah Elohika, thy God. Jehovah Rohika, our healer. Jehovah Hosein, our maker. Jehovah El Elyon, the Lord Most High. Jehovah Sabbath, the Lord God of hosts. Jehovah Maker Tishkem, the Lord our sanctifier. My daddy, you are the Most High God. You are the compassionate God. You are the ever loving God. You are the long suffering God. You are the master builder. You are the everlasting God. You are the living God. You are the eternal God. You are the great redeemer. You are the Lord God, omnipotent, so powerful, omnipresent God, present everywhere, beside God, the only God. You are the God of all comfort. You are the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. You are the God of truth. You are the God of restoration. We bless you this morning, Daddy. We honor you this morning, Daddy. When your word says, seek ye for the kingdom of God, and everything else will be added unto you. For as we gather this morning, I just happen to know that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You are all raw materials for God's ministry. You cannot be defeated, you see, because your Savior was never defeated. God has given you power tougher than all your problems. With the mighty Lord of hosts with you, I know that you will reach your goal. Amen. Your God is higher and your God is bigger than any mountain facing you. You are not for the valley. Amen. You will be heard, you will never be detained. I say with you, I join with you that you must refuse to be slaves to anybody dead or alive. Amen. No matter how tough your situation is, shall overcome. For greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Amen. You can succeed. And you will succeed where others may have failed. You shall pursue your enemies, overtake them, and recover your property from them. In the mighty name of Jesus. I know that the Lord is your light and the Lord is your salvation. For whom shall you be afraid of? The Lord is your restoration. I know that everything about you from today on shall be prosperity. In the mighty name of Jesus. Our Father and our God, we thank you for your time. As our mommy said just a few minutes ago, she said, as the Lord lives, we shall see the retirement of 2007. Amen. And we shall now start to rejoice in 2007. So 2017, I don't know about you, but 2017 for me is going to be a year of jubilance. It's going to be a year of thanksgiving. Amen. It's going to be a year of saying to God, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the blood, Jesus Christ. And so shall it be. Amen. In the name of the Father, amen, and of the Son, amen, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Please be seated. The Lord bless you.
Amen.
The Lord keep you.
Amen.
The Lord make his face to shine upon you.
Amen.
The Lord be gracious unto you.
Amen.
The Lord lift up his countenance upon you.
Amen.
And give you peace.
Amen.
Well, you know, that is a pronunciation. That the Lord will bless you.
Amen.
That the Lord will keep you.
Amen.
That the Lord will make his face to shine upon you.
Amen.
That the Lord will lift up his countenance upon you.
Amen.
And the Lord will give you his peace. His peace that passes all understanding. Amen. But the question though is, because the Bible says, as a man thinketh, so is he. When we were kids in Nigeria, kids really do not have religion. We go wherever religion is. I can tell you that when I was home in Nigeria, I was a Muslim, I was a Christian, I was Catholic. So in the morning when the Muslims are eating, before fasting, I eat with them. Then I go next door, which is our house. Number 23, Lagos, it was all Muslim. I was born at 25, Lagos, it was 4 o'clock in the morning, I will wake up and I go there and eat with them. Then when it's time to go to school, we always take sign and put it on our lips so nobody will know we're eating. And then when the Catholics come and they're having big things, as long as there's food, there we go. But I noticed one thing, and up to today, that particular information I got from them still resonates with me. They said, what does it mean to sin? Catholics is that. And it says, to sin is to yield to what you know to be right or wrong, either in words, thought, or action. Proverbs 18:21 said it differently. It says, death and life are in the power of what you say. The very first redeeming church in Canada, which was Covenant Chapel. At that time, the pastor was Pastor Ishola. He asked someone to invite me. So I went there. I've always liked to be freelance. I like to go to as many churches as possible so I can see what goes on there. The church service was excellent. I sat in the back. At the end of the service, the pastor came to me and says, so it'd be a pleasure to have you to join us. Since you live only about 10 minutes away, I said, no, you don't want me to be a member of your church. Trust me. He said, oh no, we want you to be a member of your church. No, you don't. That's why is that, sir? I said, well, can we go into your office and talk? And he says, okay. So we went to his office. I said, as I sat in the back there, you see, it is very customary for a police officer to sit with his back to the wall because we want to see everyone that comes in. I said, since I came in here, I've seen 10 people that knows me very well and I know them very well. And if I start coming here, you will lose 10 for one. Because we know each other very well outside. Pronunciation. What I'm trying to say to you is, when you pray to God and you ask him for something, as we do, as my wife does, as I do, God knows the appropriate time to answer that question or that prayer. But you know what I have seen? Lots of Saturday Christians. On Saturday, they are happy. On Sunday, they have a good time. On Monday, they are sad again. That will not be your Lord Jesus.
Amen.
When you ask the Lord, he knows the appropriate time. In fact, I believe the Bible says that you and I don't even know what to pray for. But when it hasn't come yet, guess what? People will leave here, go to next church. And you know, I listen to some of the words that people say. Oh, excuse me, madam. Ma, the Lord is, there's a man of God next door. The Lord is using him mightily. In the meantime, the Bible says that the Lord we serve is not a respecter of persons. So they live here. Unfortunately, what a sad thing. They left here just as the time that the angel of the living God was coming to meet them here.
Amen.
Then they have to start all over again. Amen. That will not be your lot.
Amen.
The other thing I found is there are seeds that we have these people in the church that either they call them elders or they call them deacons.
And there's been many times I will sit in the church, and you see, there are some responsibilities that I expect an elder to perform, or deaconess. When I come through your door, when you pick up your phone and you call 911, and I, you see me driving by and I park tonight, you expect me to catch the thief or the robbery or whatever, whoever it is, because that's why you call the police officer. But when you have elders in the church, what does the Bible say about elders? Is there anyone among you who is sick? It didn't say pastor have to do everything. Let's call the elders. Lay hands on the sick, because you are bad. See, God called you righteous people. There's nothing that ticks me off more than someone sitting in the church say, I am deacon so-so-so. I am deacon so-so-so. But what do you do with your post? How are you serving God? So if you say, the Lord bless you, the Lord keep you, the Lord make his face to shine upon you, if you see six children because you are the elder or because you are the deacon and you pray for them, is that too much? Just short a while ago, the pastor says it's time for the kids to go to their own room. I'm not going to single anybody out, but you know who you are. As an elder of this church, as a deacon of this church, how many times have you left this sanctuary to go and pray for those kids? Or do they have to be your own biological sons and daughters? My attitude is, if you can't do what it takes, don't accept the post. If you're going to accept the post, then do what it says.
Amen.
I asked a pastor once, and I purpose to do this thing because I'm in Nigeria, they call them area boys. I'm one of the area boys. I like to put my nose where it doesn't belong. And the reason why I do that, I say is that, well, even if the pastor says, well, it's none of your business, I just remind him that, sir, you are the pastor of this church, but I carry a gun. So if you're going to fight with me, be very careful. So I asked a pastor once, may I please see your board of directors? So at the end of the church, we had a meeting, and I saw the members of the board of directors. I said, well, everyone that's sitting here today, they are definitely over the age of 30. He said, that's correct, sir. Where are the young people under the age of 17? Oh, no, they are not responsible enough. Well, my, let me tell you, the youngest kid in this church can figure out a brand new cell phone more than any of you can figure out. But the reason why we don't want them in the board is because they always say what they see. So when the so-called treasurers and the financial secretary are putting the money of the Almighty God in their pockets, who wants the kids to be there to tell the pastor about it? Come on now. The kingdom of God is so very violent. And violent ticket by force. I was in a church one time and they were singing. I was still sitting there. They were praising God. And the next song they saw, the sign was that, let us lift our holy hands in one accord. And unfortunately, I'm sorry, I just couldn't keep my mouth shut. So I said, excuse me. And just exactly where did you get that holy hand from? Who told you you have holy hands? That covenant chapel that I told you about, the very first one in Canada, immediately after the service, myself and one of the elders were standing outside after the service, and I had a meeting with the pastor. You know, one of the choir members was at the door there on her phone, and I tell you, that woman was cursing somebody on the phone. I'd rather stay home and worship God than go to church. You come to a church, you pray, you praise, you bless, and then as soon as they step out, the real them come out. Pronunciations. In the beginning, God created heaven and the earth. And God pronounced, let there be light. And God says, let there be waters. And the Lord says, let there be land. And the Lord pronounced again, let there be fruit trees. And the Lord pronounced, let there be man and woman. That's God's pronunciation. And then the word of God says, and the Lord blessed them. Listen to some of this other pronunciation. Genesis 18:12. Therefore, Sarah laughed within herself, saying, after I am waxed so old, shall I now have a child? Yes, I know you have prayed. We all have desires. You have prayed. But God hasn't answered that prayer for a reason. Because he is not ready yet. Remember, he says to every one of us that at the sight of evil, what did he say we should do? Excuse me? He says to flee. And that is when he's busy with somebody else. So in the meantime, flee. But when he is ready, you know what he says? When he says to flee, the evil he's talking about are your enemies, isn't it? But that same God now turn around in the believing the book of Psalm 23 verse 5. He says, listen, I told you that when your enemies are around, you must flee. But when I, the Almighty God, God of Abraham, God of Isaac, God of Jacob, is ready to bless you, I will not do it unless all those enemies are present.
Hallelujah.
Isn't that what you say, Mama?
Oh, yes, sir.
I was going through Exodus 12 just last week. And you know how you read the Bible 10 million times, and then all of a sudden, something happens. Do you know, I pray for everyone here today, you will not be in bondage in Jesus' name.
Amen.
430 years, the children of Israel were in bondage in Egypt. Am I correct?
Yeah.
But if you look at when the Lord was ready to free them, I was so surprised to read in Exodus 12, verse 51, that when the Lord was ready to deliver the children of Israel, not only did he deliver them, he delivered them with their great armies. So for 430 years, while the children of Israel were in slavery, their great armies were also in slavery with them. These are the same army that worked out with them, and every other country comes along, those same armies were defeating them along the way. What do I get from that? Unless the Lord builds the house.
Oh.
Those who are building, build in vain. Unless the Lord watches, even a police officer like myself, I'm wasting my time. A very good friend of ours, who is a judge in the high court, called me 2 weeks ago. And she said, Ojo, I am so disappointed in our system, even though I'm a judge. And I said, why is that? She said, every time somebody walked into my courtroom, think about it. In order to go onto the witness stand, they are given a Bible. I promise to tell the truth, nothing but the truth, so help me God. That's what they say. That's what they still say. However, if a judge sitting behind the bench says, my God, she'll be removed from bench immediately in this country. Pronunciation. On the appointed day, Herod, wearing his royal robes, sat on his throne and delivered a public address to the people. They all shouted, this is the voice of a God, not of a man. And because of that pronunciation that Herod made, you know something? That was the first record of cancer in the entire world. Because the Bible says he was eaten alive by worms. Please watch what you say. Because you never know who's listening. In the first book, 1 Kings 19, while Elijah was on Mount Sinai, this is the fire-breathing dragon, the Lord asked him, Elijah, what are you doing here? Elijah said, Lord, I've always been at my best and I obey you, but your people have broken their solemn promise to you. They have torn down your altars and killed all your prophets except me. Now they are even trying to kill me. They, he says, they are even trying to kill me. He was only running away from Jezebel. Where did they come in from? You see, you have to know who you are in the Lord. And trust me, you don't need Pastor Fulani to tell you. There's no class with God. Just as important as Pastor Fulani is with God, so are you. You just have to know him. How could you pray to God this morning, and then someone tells you, oh, Mama, there's one guy that back home who is worshiping God of idol. He's the one chasing me in my dream. What is the point of you having a living God? Because that's why in that prayer I was saying before that greater is he that is in you than he that's in the world. God knows that you are raw materials for his miracle.
Hallelujah.
You cannot be defeated because Jesus Christ you worship was never defeated.
Amen.
God has given you power tougher than the problem you are looking at.
Amen.
That's what the Bible says. The problem is we have to realize that when you are called redeemed, you have been redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
2 Chronicles, if my people redeem Christian Church of God, if they are, as they are being called by my name, if they will humble themselves, pray and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven. What are the requirements as a member of the Redeemed Christian Church? You must be a people of God. You must be called by his name. You must humble yourself. You know, humility is something that many of us find very difficult to do. The first time I saw the picture of Daddy Adeboye, a man who is a professor of not mathematics, but applied mathematics, and the Lord brought him down so low that he was standing beside a man who doesn't speak a word of English. And he had to interpret for that man. Well, any man, any of us would have got angry. I have a PhD. I have a BSc, and I have to be interpreting for a man who doesn't speak. But is it the man that the Lord wants you to be answering to, or to him, God Almighty? Well, because of his humility, look what happened to Adeboye today. Look what happened to Adeboye today. When the building at 66 Toro Road, which is Covenant Chapel, when they bought that building, I was called upon to come and assist because I also do construction. Trust me, you have no idea how many things I do. You know how Canadians will say jack of all trade? Except that I don't mind you saying jack of all trade, but don't you ever say master of nothing, because I still have my gun. I went there, I looked at the building, and I gave them up from the top of my head what will cause them to do the job. What they want to do is to put a second floor there. And I was trained by Italians. I was an electrician, but you find that in Canada, when you are an electrician, you must know plumbing, you must know how to put up studs, you must know how to put up drywall and everything. So I went there and I gave them the advice. But to my surprise, the following Sunday, it was announced in the church that somebody was coming to give an estimate, and it was going to draw a blueprint. And I have no business with the church as much. But I said, excuse me, if you call somebody, you say you are strapped for money. If you call somebody to come and draw you a blueprint, the law of this country says that when they give you an estimate of what will cost you to build that whatever you want to build, the blueprint they are going to draw will also cost you 25% of the total amount. So in other words, if you want to put a second floor on this building and you need a blueprint and the guy came and drew it and said it's going to cost you $200,000 to build it, you will have to pay by law, you have to pay him 25% of that $200,000 as his, what he gets to do the blueprints. So I said, but the thing is, I am the one who is going to do the major job there. I don't need a blueprint. But someone anyways managed to convince the board that they need a blueprint. When the man drew the blueprint, he came back and he submitted. I was there. And he said it's going to cost the church $250,000 to build it. And he wants $25,000 for his job. Then one man got up and said, sir, we did not ask you to do the blueprints. The other one says, well, we just asked you to give us a sample of what the blueprints would be like. Well, their understanding was at the time that as long as you do not sign something, there is no contract. But you don't have to sign anything. So I got up and I says, listen guys, you owe the guy $25,000. The sooner you pay it, the lesser I will have to enforce and be on his side. He paid it. And you know something? I never once opened that blueprint because I don't need it. Pronunciation. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, who do men say that I am? And who do you say that I am? Peter was the first one to go. You are Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And Jesus says, Peter, upon this rock, I will build my church. And the gates of hell will not prevail against it. The gates of hell will not prevail against your life in Jesus' name. Yes. Just before we came in here, I was saying to Daddy, I said, you know, I beg of you, please, hold on to him. Bug him to death. You have my permission. And if you keep bugging him every day and he get angry at you, tell him to call me because I'm the one who told you to do it. But whatever you do, find a way, let him take you to Israel. Trust me, your life will never be the same again.
Amen.
My wife and I just came back. We spent a month there.
Oh, wow.
And we went to every single place that's possible. And some of the things we found that you will not see on the news is the fact that as you hear and see the Jewish people and the Palestinians fighting the Gaza Strip every day, it is so interesting that 55% of all the drinking water in Israel and 55% of the hydro in Israel, Jewish people give it to the Palestinians every day free.
That's right.
In spite of all that.
That's right.
You will not be told that in the Parliament House, there is almost 50% Israeli Palestinian working in that building. The only thing we found very, very strange is that when we took a tour one day to go to Jerusalem and then Bethlehem the same day, and we were surprised when we were told that you need your passport. Because we're just going like from Toronto to Ottawa. But we took our passport anyways. But soon as we crossed the border, we realized that the Israeli vehicles are not allowed in Bethlehem.
That's right.
So we had to park, and then Palestinians came with their bus and took us on the ride, on the tour. But in Jerusalem, one thing struck me. Actually, no, let me put it straight. I don't want to, because you know how men like to boast and say, I did this, I did that. One thing struck my wife. All right. I somehow knew you were going to say that. Something struck my wife. And she said, Leah, can you believe this? What's that? You see, when Joseph of Arimathea asked for the body of Jesus Christ, he wanted to clean it, perfume it, and then put it into proper burial. The stone upon which he washed the body of Christ, that particular stone, we were told 2,000 years ago, still the one that's there right now. In some areas, they will tell you that they have made adjustments. But in some areas, I say, no, that's a real accord. But what struck my wife was that, you know, when you think of Israel, at least for me, I think Christian. When you think of Mecca, you think Muslim. But my wife, she's a very small woman, but don't mess with her. Get in there so that you can kneel down and pray and things like that. And it's full of all Chinese, those people that wear Muslim that wear turbans. And everybody was crying on the stone. So my wife was wondering, what is it to these people? And then it dawned on us that we are liars. Is it not the same father? Abraham on one side is Isaac. Abraham on the other side is Ishmael. And these people are killing themselves every day. But what you also find in Israel is that of all these people that are fighting, the Palestinians, only about 15% of them. The rest couldn't even care less what's going on. But if you think that the Israelis live peace every day, that's not true. They live on tension every day. Because you have no idea what's going to happen, where it's going to happen. Every mall in Israel, you cannot go into it without being searched at the door. But even though you are being searched, we went shopping in Hadera, my wife and I, with a friend. And the car we were driving was searched, and they said, it's okay, we can go in. We went in, we did the shopping, we went back to our kibbutz. And by the time we got there, my wife turned it, I turned it to you. And it says, breaking news. Two Arab boys, 11 years old and 12 years old, got into the mall. They have no knives, no guns, nothing. But as soon as they walk in, remember I said it's a mall. So of course there's a food court. They went to the food court, got a knife from there. So some of the employees working in the mall, from what we understand, the woman has turned around to take something on the shelf to show a customer, and the 11-year-old jumped on the counter, drove the knife into her back, and it took off. That is the kind of life the Israelis live. On Highway 4 leads from our hotel in Hadera all the way to Tel Aviv. On that same Highway 4, a couple were coming from the synagogue after a wedding on Saturday morning, and they were going to the banquet hall. So after a little while on the Highway 4, like Young Street, now you see traffic light. So they had stopped, the Jewish family had stopped at the red light, and two Arabs on the other side jumped out of their car, run to them, shot both of them, killed them, and then they took off. But what has happened is, they were driving an SUV, and the back of it was tinted. So the Arab did not see that there were four boys sitting in the back. So they were saved. But they also watched the execution of their parents. I know we are all Christians. And I know the Bible says that thou shalt forgive. But we are all human beings. Those four young boys, what do you think it would take for them to forgive those Arabs? Because now they have no parents anymore. So I ask you this morning, the weather is nice. If you truly are a redeemed, you tell me from your conscience. The weather is very nice. Barry police were driving around. And daddy have said, because it's beautiful Saturday afternoon, you are going to have barbecue outside. Because, of course, to pastor, every barbecue, every Christmas party, everything is about evangelism. So you are having barbecue outside. The police stopped. They don't trust me. The only reason why we stop is to see if the steak is good and any extra. But you started preaching to us. What do we care about your God? We just want to eat. But you preach and we do so. The man says, okay, you convince me. But you want me to become redeemed. I want pastor to give me the opportunity to live with one of you for 6 months in your house. At the end of 6 months, If I see that you are redeemed, then I will believe in your redemption. So I ask you, if a total stranger walked into your barbecue and wanted to believe Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior, if he lived with you for 6 months, will he still be interested in becoming redeemed? Mahatma Gandhi, that's what he wanted all his life. His parents were Hindu. They worship or whatever it is they worship. But he said he woke up one morning, after seeing his parents worshiping whatever this thing is, he just couldn't convince himself that it's the right way to go. So he wanted to see this other guy, because he saw, he says, Jesus Christ died on the cross for all. He said, well, to me, that is a perfect act. For one man to die even for somebody he doesn't even know. He wanted to know more about it. He was a lawyer. But at that time, he was in South Africa. So one morning, he decided, I am going to go to church. I don't want anything to do with my parents, so many gods anymore. I will have you know that in India, there's at least 3 million gods. Minimum. My wife can tell you, while we were in Israel, we saw a documentary whereby they worship, there's a special time of the year they worship monkeys. And you better not kill a monkey. They have a big statue of monkey that they worship. And they were reporting that they love these monkeys so much, they feed them, they do everything, but the monkeys now become thieves. So when they are baking cake or cooking food, if they don't close the window, the monkey jump in, watch them, take the food and take off. And you better not be found killing one of them. And for a few of them that actually attack the monkeys bite them and give them rabies. That's their God. The God that gives his children rabies. Can you believe that? In the book of Ezekiel 37, God can do whatever he wants. But he called a man by Ezekiel. Says, look, I want you to prophesy into those dry bones. Is there any of us here this morning that don't have some kind of a dry bone? Mommy says, have prayer to every one of you that you will attend the retirement of 2016.
Amen.
Do you receive it? Amen. It's one thing to receive it, but what do you want to do? What do you want God to do for you in 2017? That's the prophecy. Whatever that dry bone is, it perhaps may be unemployment, it may be a fruit of the womb, it may be I don't have to ask him. I can tell you what his desires is. Because we're in the same area. Good health. That's it. I used to wonder, I would tell my wife, we're going to buy that house. No, no, no. Lord, please. Let me just speak. I don't want heart attack. We don't care anymore about houses or new car, whatever it is. If I get there, the car starts, I'll go. If it doesn't, as we are coming to your church this morning, they were saying on the news that, oh, it's going to start snowing, and then it's going to continue till tomorrow, and then it's going to be 12 meters, it's going to be 12 centimeters, it's going to be 12 inches. And I say to my wife, what do we do? So if it starts snowing, we just won't leave the bed. We're just staying bed. We are unemployed anyways. Am I right, sir? You don't have to go out. But for some of you that still have to go out, for some of you that look, like I said, are looking for the fruit of the womb, for some of you that are looking for promotion, for some of you that are looking for a wife, for some that are looking for a husband, perhaps it is immigration thing, are you going to prophesy that 2017 will be your year of thanksgiving?
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
The covenant. Covenant chapel. But all within Christian church are full of covenants. I received my, how can I put it to you? I received my one of my biggest desires in life 3 years ago. Yes. Mommy and Daddy Gio just came here. I believe they are coming in June. They have just come, and I went to see them. We sat down, we were talking, and Mommy said, you know, you come to Nigeria every time, you never even make, listen to this statement made by Mommy Gio. She said, you come to Nigeria every time, you never even once make any attempt to come and visit us. And I was going to say to her, Mommy, no, I should be the one making that statement. I can live here, go to Nigeria, purposely just to visit you, if I can just get through the door. And Mommy said, when are you coming next? I said, in about 3 months. Okay, well, this is, call me when you get there. And I said, is it possible that my dream is going to come true? So we left. We went home. We went to Nigeria. We got there. And I called her. No, actually, I'm sorry. I didn't call her. I emailed her. Because we talk on email all the time. We are in Nigeria now. When would be good for you, for us to come see you? So this is my brother-in-law's phone number where we were staying. So on Sunday morning, about 6, she called. Of course, the phone went to my brother-in-law's bedroom. He picked it up. He spoke to this lady, and the lady wanted to speak to me. And she told him who she was. So he came to our bedroom, and this was his statement. Quote, there's some lady on the phone claiming to be Mrs. Adeboye wants to be. So I picked up the phone, I spoke to Mom, and she said, about Tuesday, I said, that's good. And she was trying to give me direction how to get there. So I said, Mom, I left Nigeria 45 years ago. Even Lagos, where I was born, I have to look for it now. But I'll give the phone to my in-law. He's the one who's going to drive anyway. You talk to him. She said, okay. So she gave him the direction and everything. And the phone was over. Then he now looked at me and my wife. He says, so who was that? I said, who did you speak to? She said, oh, come on. You're always joking around. Who? And I'm not kidding. That's exactly the way he put it. And who are you that Mr. Adeboye will be calling you? I said, well, but you are taking us there on Tuesday, right? So when we get there, you will know whether it's them or not. So Tuesday, but he has 4 drivers. This man is 76 years old. He has a business. But he said to the driver, no, I'm going to drive. Okay, so he drove. We went there. We got to the door. And after about 1 hour, a guy came in a unlicensed BMW. And he says, are you Constable Andrew? I says, yeah, I am. So Mommy says, please to come with me. I'm going to take you to where she did. Actually, they were not at home. So we went and we met with them. My in-law was there. We went to Habitation of Hope, which is another camp of redeem. Then by the time we came back, food was ready for us. Mom has prepared, because we are both from the same area, so she prepared Ijesha's food. My in-law ate it. I'm sure he ate more than we did. And Mom put a crate of Maltex in our trunk when we were leaving. We got home. He took the Maltex. He says, well, if you need more tests, I will buy you another one. But this one stays here. So that's fine. After all that, you see, Thomas says, unless I put my finger on his side, I will not believe. My brother-in-law put his finger in the amola that Mommy made, took Mommy's small text, which was rightfully mine, and he still didn't believe. We got home, and he said, I know it's Mrs. Adeboye for sure, And if you didn't come, and but so who are you? And I said, God has a way of answering people's prayers. As this year is coming to an end, the God of Adeboye will answer your prayers.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Some of the things I want you to please stay away from. Ezekiel 18, 1 to 3. The word of the Lord came to me. What do you people mean by quoting this proverb about the land of Israel? The parents eat sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. As surely as I live, declares the Almighty God, you will no longer quote this proverb in your life.
Amen.
Amen.
You know, in some way I can even understand the unbelievers. How dare you, a believer, go to a doctor for whatever it is, and the doctor says, oh, you have headache. Oh yeah, it runs in my family. It runs in your family. That's what the Bible is saying. It doesn't run in your family.
Yes.
As far as you are concerned, you are the stop sign.
Amen.
For everything that is negative in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So today I pray with you. But by the reason of the blood,
amen,
you will not bear the yoke of your enemies.
Amen. Amen.
You will not inherit generational sickness.
Amen.
I said by the reason of the blood, you will not inherit cancer.
Amen. Amen.
That will not be your portion.
Amen.
That will not be your portion.
Amen.
That will be a first stroke that rendered a man or a woman useless will not be your portion.
Amen.
And you know something? I don't. I've been to doctor many times, and my doctor will say, "Sir, do you have history of your parents to see what they have?" I says, "Do you have history of anything wrong with me?" He said, "Why do you want to go to my parents?" The RCMP sent me one time because I was being foolish. That's what my wife said I was being. I have spent many years with Toronto Police. But you know how, like, sometimes you're doing one job and you want something else? So I wanted to leave Toronto Police. I wanted to go to the RCMP. And part of the test you have to do is to go to a dentist to check your teeth. So I went to Bellevue and everything, Dr. Johnston. I sat on his chair when he called me in. He says to open my mouth. I did. He was clanging, going up and down, and says to me, he said, "Do you have any false teeth?" I says, "No." He said, "When was the last time you saw a dentist?" I says, "Today." He said, "Look at my age again. You've never seen a dentist before?" I says, "No." "Then what brought you here today?" I said, "So if you read the firewall, you see that I was sent by the RCMP." He said, "Oh, okay, you are one of those, no one, because I'm looking at your file there, and your teeth, you have all your teeth?" I said, "By the grace of God, yes, I do. You see, as you are right now, when the Lord made you, it's a quality control." He looked at you again, and you know what he says? "He's good."
Yeah.
"She's good."
Yeah.
All I ask you, sometimes, remember, even the doctors, they are in a ministry.
Mm-hmm.
But what I beg of you in Jesus' name, if you have to go to a doctor and the doctor has to give you any prescription, don't fight with them, because that's their ministry. And if you don't take it, you will die. I'm telling you, even my mother will tell you, "I take my medication when the doctor gives it to me." But what I ask you to do, when you pick up that prescription, please cover it with the blood of Jesus. Just say, "Dad, this is what the world gave me, and you are the one that created that ministry. But I am not taking this prescription, I'm taking the blood of Jesus Christ."
Yeah.
And then take it in faith. Because before you even put it in your mouth, the King of Glory has done the job anyway.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
So don't fight with them. Take what they ask you to take. But the only thing I'm going to tell you to be militant. If they say to you, "Oh, you've got this." "Oh, no, 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 no. I don't have it, doctor. You see wrong. You see, because everything that doctor tells you have, he's only saying because computer tell him to say it.
Yeah.
They take a small blood from you, they put it in the computer, and then they come back. Oh, you got it. No. That's not what Jesus told me.
Oh, yes.
Pastor can tell you, he knows the pastor in charge of Dominion Chapel, Pastor Adeshina Olujebe. One day, his wife, my baby, falls sick. Look how this God works. She fell sick. She was home alone. She picked up her phone. God gave her just enough power to dial 911, and then she collapsed. She didn't talk to them. But they knew where the call came from. They rushed in there. By the time they got in there, they rushed out to Etobicoke General Hospital. They called the husband. They called some people to come. And then they said, sorry, she has passed away. Please go into the room and say your last rites before we take her to the morgue. But there was an angel standing beside Pastor Dujebe. And that angel said to him, ask the doctor, before they pronounce death, have they done this? Just ask. So the pastor asked. And the doctor said, oh, that's an expensive thing. We don't. Pastor, tell them to do it. They did it. What happened? I'm not kidding you. This woman was already blue. Her fingers are turning black because the heart stopped, the kidney stopped, the liver stopped, her mouth is blue, her toes and everything. But the doctor said, well, I guess he doesn't know how the pastor found out about that particular thing. But since you asked for it so that we will not be sued, they did it. And the woman who was dead opened her eyes. And pastor couldn't do anything but to be crying there. He called me. Sir, you're not going to believe what happened. I said, well, if it has to do with the Lord, what's there not to believe? They rushed out from there to Trinity General Hospital. And they got there and they told them. They said, okay, well, although we were able to revive your wife, but she's going to be on dialysis for the rest of her life because the kidney cannot produce anymore. So at least she's alive. That woman, Mrs. Odujebe, was on dialysis machine for 2 weeks. And then they took it off, they said she doesn't need it anymore. Look, pastor may go on a conference. It is not unusual. He may go on Holy Ghost night in Lagos. But Jesus is still here.
Yes.
Must the pastor be here for a few of you to get together and cry to the eternal heaven? D.K. Olukoya, a mountain of fire. He was out of the country. And one of his main men in the church was sick. So the wife called. They said, oh, daddy is away. What are we going to do now? So they sent one of the pastors. So by the time they called the pastor, ah, sir, this is an emergency, you have to go. So he said, but my wife is not home. I have my 7-year-old boy, I'm looking, okay, all right. So, okay, well, I will take it. So he took the young boy, he went to the house of the man. He got in there. He walked into the room where the man was laying. He prayed. The little boy disappeared, playing around. When the man of God finished praying, this is the man who went to represent D.K. Olukoya. He came out. He says to the wife, Mama, put your house in order. Your husband is finished. So we will start doing the burial arrangement with you. And I'm sure that when daddy returns, he'll be more than happy to pitch in. And we will support you and things like that. So God bless you, ma. It is well. It is well. I'm so sorry. And things. And then he was about to walk out the door. Oh, where's my son? Well, Mama, my son. Where did this boy go? This boy, I will tell him that, for I don't want to take him anywhere. They look eventually. They saw the 7-year-old boy walking out of the bedroom with the man who was dying. The young boy went behind his father as the man gave testimony, jumped up the man's chest and started to say, Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus. I'm assuming that's what he hears his father says. And you know what? the angel of the living God says, as you ask, so shall it be. Amen. So what daddy could not do, 7 years was enough. If anyone tells you that your case is difficult, tell them they don't know the God of Adeboye. In 2017, I want you to please keep one thing in mind. As long as you are under the blood, you know how when there's an emergency, we call 911? Has anyone ever called 911? But you know it's there. Well, do you have your 911?
Yes.
So call it. Jesus. He who dwells under the secret place of the Most High God shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty God. You have your own 911 for the children of God. Just call him. If he's bold enough to give you his son to die on the cross, what else do you want to ask him that he will not give you? The only thing as a redeemed, please, never, ever, ever feel that somebody offends you and you cannot forgive them. You must forgive them.
Amen.
Not for their sake, but so that it doesn't stop your prayer.
Amen.
You see what I'm saying?
Amen.
Don't let, in fact, if you come in here, daddy is going to do communion. If you know that there is someone who has offended you badly, that you have not forgiven yet, I beg of you, Jesus is not as hard as people make him to be. Where you are standing or sitting, just call upon him. Say, sir, effective immediately, I forgive that person. Remember I said, what does it mean to sin? To sin is to yield to what we know to be right or wrong, either in word, thought, or action. So when you say it, when you pronounce it, Jesus is listening.
Amen.
Forgive that person.
Amen.
Once you forgive that person, then I take the communion. Second thing and final. Look with me in the book of Matthew 18. Matthew chapter 18, verse 10. You see those little children that were taken away just now? They are the most important to God. That can stop your prayer. Trust me. If you don't treat them right, what did Matthew 18 say? Anyone? But Matthew 8, verse 10. If you get there, please read it. Matthew 18, verse 10.
Take heed that ye despise not one of these little ones. For I say unto you that in heaven their angels do always behold the face of my Father which is in heaven.
Please take a look at that statement very well. Not all angels see God. Not all of them. There are some special angels like Michael, like Gabriel, like Uriel, that actually see the face of God. You know that every time Gabriel or Michael go out, they always say, I'm the Lord. Oh, my Lord, what are you doing here? And those angels, they are the one that God assigned to little children. That's why I was saying, if you are an elder or a deacon or deaconess in this church, pray for those little ones. And even if you are not an elder, pray for them anyways. Because when you start praying for the little ones and the angels are watching you, remember, when you write your prayer request, they are the ones that are going to take it to the Almighty God. You know how today they tell you to bring your resume for 2 positions and 10,000 resumes coming. Once you get to the HR, if you come in there and you behave some irrational things, what do you think they're going to do to your resume? They throw the garbage. As you celebrate Christmas, as you're looking forward to 2017, I'd like to borrow a couple of prayers from my daddy Dio to usher you into 2017. And right now I say to every one of you here this morning, that God of Adeboye will take you higher than your dreams.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
You will enjoy success without a sweat.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Because God of Adeboye is the controller of heaven and earth. all the powers in heaven will come to your assistance.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
That is said, the resources of the earth will flow into you.
Amen.
Beginning from this moment on, helpers will seek to help you out.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Because of God of Ademoye in heaven will be a shield over you, destroyers will not come to your house.
Amen.
As long as there is water in the ocean, your anointing will never run dry.
Amen.
As long as I follow the night, you will enjoy the mercies of God in Jesus.
Amen.
The Lord will bless you.
Amen.
The Lord will keep you.
Amen.
The Lord will make his face to shine upon you. The power of the Almighty God will radiate in your life.
Amen.
And I pray with you today that in 2017, nobody in this place here will be a borrower.
Amen.
You'll be a lender.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I said to Daddy once, I said, this is a beautiful lot the Lord gave you. And I'm praying that, because Daddy and Debo, you always say that if they want to do any project in Nigeria, they don't need to announce it, because one person will just get up and says, leave it with me. I don't know who wants to receive that blessing this morning. But I'm saying to you, any of you that want to receive that blessing, and I give it to you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
When Daddy Folari says, we want to move this building, the church, to the back, it's going to cost $5 million to build it. To any of you that want to take that project, that $5 million will be like, it will be like $5 to the
church.
And so shall it be.
Amen.
In the name of the Father,
amen,
and of the Son,
amen,
and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
Thank you for inviting us. And I already told Daddy that
holy is your word that I've hidden in my heart. Holy is your word that was there from the start. It cuts like a knife and it's sharp like a sword.